Okay, so the next presentation we have is about clinical dilemmas that we have in our medical wards. And over the next half an hour, I'll take you to three presentations of the same patient where we actually have therapeutic clinical dilemmas. So this is a case scenario. We have a 55-year-old patient with diabetes, hypertension, chronic kidney disease, and multiple myeloma presenting to the casualty medical unit with chest pain and shortness of breath for 1 hour. Her medication at present includes metformin 500 twice daily, sitagliptin 100 daily, losartan 50 BD, and atorvastatin 40 noctate. Her blood pressure was 94/70, and her heart rate was 84, and her respiratory rate was 16. And the initial ECG taken shows there's ST elevation in the anteroseptal leads. The point of care troponin done reveals 10 nanograms per milliliter. As this patient has multiple myeloma, she has visited a hematology clinic last week, and the investigations done at the clinic a week ago is present with the patient. So you see the investigations, the total white cell count is 8,000, the hemoglobin is 9, the platelet is 38,000, and the creatinine is 1. So in this clinical scenario, we have two problems. One is the patient has acute coronary syndrome because the patient has presented with a typical chest pain, and there is an ECG showing an ST elevation, and the cardiac biomarker, which is troponin, is positive. So we have a definite diagnosis of acute coronary syndrome. But we also have another problem at our hand, and that is thrombocytopenia. Because the patient has multiple myeloma, the patient has a platelet count of 38,000. So in this scenario, we have to treat the acute coronary syndrome. And as we all know, the cornerstone of management of acute coronary syndrome involves antiplatelets, heparin, thrombolytics, PCI. And all of which cause problems in a patient with thrombocytopenia. So there is our clinical dilemma. So to help us solve this dilemma, I have with me Chamara. So Chamara, I would like to ask you as a first question, in this kind of scenario, can we give antiplatelets? And if we do decide to give antiplatelets, which antiplatelet is the best drug? And what is the lowest platelet count you would consider giving antiplatelets for?
Thank you, Tushara, for the questions, and thank you for inviting me as well for this forum. So yes, it's an interesting case, and it's something that we do encounter quite often in clinical practice. So it's good to know, and it's probably good to know what to do and what not to do, I guess, in another sense as well. So the patient whom we are dealing with obviously has multiple comorbidities, including multiple myeloma. So before doing anything, probably it's good to know two things. So we are dealing with an ST elevation myocardial infarction. It's a life-threatening medical complication, obviously. And as we learned throughout our medical career, ST elevation MIs, the saying goes is that time is muscle. So what we do, we must do it fast, and we have to do it as soon as possible, whatever treatment modality that we are going to do, and that decision has to be made as soon as possible. The number two thing, especially with any patient who has cancer or any form of cancer, is that we need to have an idea about the prognosis, because whatever we do, whatever active treatment that we do, we need to do it so that the patient's best interest is also at heart. So if the patient's prognosis as far as the cancer is concerned is not that great, so I would look at the life expectancy of this patient as well to see if they have a reasonable life expectancy, and then I will decide on what treatments I will go for in this patient. So assuming that this patient has a reasonable life expectancy with the multiple myeloma, I would probably go for active treatment. And to answer the question, so as far as antiplatelets, so we are dealing with a patient who has a baseline level of 38,000 platelets, and we have that luxury. Sometimes, though, to be honest with you, we don't have that luxury. Whenever a patient comes with a STEMI to the emergency department, we don't know what the platelet levels are. So again, our treatment will depend, and it will be for the treatment of that life-threatening problem. As Dr. Chandrika mentioned in his talk previously, we have to always deal with the immediate life-threatening issue. So as far as antiplatelet, to answer the question again, so as far as the first antiplatelet that we give, and that's the proven one throughout the last few years, the last few decades, aspirin definitely has to be given. And if the platelet count is more than 10,000, there is reasonable evidence that we can give aspirin as a load-in dose or maintenance dose as well, if the platelet count is more than 10,000. So in this patient, aspirin definitely will be indicated. The question is about then what do we give next? So obviously in a patient who is having a STEMI, an ST elevation myocardial infarction, we need to give another antiplatelet as well. So the second antiplatelet, a P2Y12 inhibitor. So again, the options-wise, we have clopidogrel and the newer antiplatelet agents, such as ticagrelor and prasugrel. So the important thing here again is that as far as the second antiplatelet is concerned, we have to go by the platelet count again. If the platelet count is more than 30,000 or between 30 and 50,000, that's kind of our cutoff. If it's more than 50,000, there is no question we can give. But again, if it's between 30 and 50,000, clopidogrel is the choice. There is no evidence to support the newer antiplatelets in patients who have platelet counts less than 50,000. So prasugrel, ticagrelor, and the 2B3A inhibitors, unfortunately, there is no evidence to support their use. So we can give clopidogrel in these patients. If the platelet count is less than 30,000, this is a hypothetical situation. So in our patient who's 38,000, I think we could give it. If the platelet counts are less than 30,000, it will require some sort of an MDT again. We need to have a chat with the patient, the patient's family, an oncology and hematology team as to, again, prognosis and have a risk-benefit analysis. And if the benefit of giving the antiplatelets, dual antiplatelets, will outweigh the risks as far as bleeding is concerned, and if the patient has a reasonable prognosis, then clopidogrel can be given again. However, in this patient, aspirin and clopidogrel combination will be a good option.
Thank you, Shyamala. So moving along, we have two options after we give the initial antiplatelets. So we can either thrombolyze the patient if we are in a non-PCI capable hospital. But if we are in a PCI capable hospital, we can go ahead with PCI. Most of us work in non-PCI capable hospitals, Shyamala. So I would like to ask you, with this platelet count of 38,000, can we give tenecteplase?
Yes, another very good question. So again, speaking of non-PCI centers, so the real guidelines actually, so even if you are in a non-PCI center, always remember, if you have a possibility of transferring this patient to a PCI center within 120 minutes, that's 2 hours, that should always be considered as number one, because as we all know, in a patient with a STEMI, primary PCI is the best mode of treatment, and the outcomes are best if you are able to offer the patient primary PCI. So even if you are in a non-PCI center, always contact the closest PCI center, find out if they have the ability to take the patient over, and if you are able to transfer the patient within 2 hours to the PCI center, that should be your number one option. However, unfortunately, due to logistical problems, it's not always possible. So we need to consider thrombolysis in this patient, again, as something as a life-saving option. So in this patient of ours, we knew a baseline platelet count. But again, most of the time, I feel that when a patient comes with all these comorbidities to our emergency department, we don't know what their platelets are, actually, because majority of the patients just come, even if a full blood count was done a month ago, 2 months ago, 6 months ago. So sometimes ignorance is bliss. We don't know what the platelet is. We just treat the patient as they are, face value, and we do the best that we can to save that patient's life. So that should be our number one priority. Again, there are no hard and fast rules as far as whether we can give thrombolysis or not. But if you look at the drug labels, etc., as far as thrombolysis is concerned, tenecteplase, which is the drug that is used commonly these days, but says as a relative contraindication, the platelet count is less than 100,000, it's considered a relative contraindication. So that's essentially putting the ball in your court. You make a decision, you make a call, a clinical judgment, whether you could give thrombolysis in this patient or not. So again, there have been case reports where they have given thrombolytics and tenecteplase in patients who have platelets less than 100,000, and the outcomes have been good. So my suggestion again is we need to have a talk, consider many things, including the patient's prognosis. Again, if the patient has a reasonable prognosis and we are doing this to save the patient's life, I think giving tenecteplase in this patient who is having a platelet count of less than 38,000 is a reasonable option, as long as there is no major bleeding, for example, then the patient has a good prognosis. Giving tenecteplase in this patient would be a good option if PCI is not an option.
Okay, so moving along, as I mentioned, the other option that we have is PCI. So with this kind of low platelets, Shyamra, can we go ahead with PCI? And if we do decide to go ahead with PCI, are there any measures that you all take as cardiologists to minimize the bleeding risk?
Yes, and I think in this kind of a patient who is having bleeding problems, PCI probably is one of the better options, because again, thrombolysis would cause trouble as far as bleeding is concerned. So whenever the option is available, I think it is definitely something to consider. So given PCI, so let's just go through the steps again. If we are to take this patient into the cath lab, a patient with thrombocytopenia, the good news is that doing a diagnostic coronary angiogram in this patient is no problem. There is no lower limit as far as platelets are concerned to do a diagnostic coronary angiogram. So we can take into the cath lab, see what the coronary anatomy is, and it's a PCI, it's a STEMI, so we would expect a completely occluded coronary artery in this patient. And as far as access is concerned, as was spoken about in this previous patient as well, who had bleeding problem and warfarin, etc. In any patient where there is some sort of a bleeding complication, radial access is preferred over the femoral approach. Again, proven to be less problematic as far as bleeding is concerned. So as far as access is concerned, we go radially. Then problem comes as to if we are to intervene in this patient as far as angioplasty is concerned, which is probably the best option. How do we go about it, and which antiplatelets do we give in this patient in that case? So obviously, if we are going for an intervention in a STEMI patient, we need to give the patient dual antiplatelets. If the platelet count is less than 50,000, usually giving these antiplatelets is going to be the problem about duration more than which antiplatelet that we give. So clopidogrel will be the antiplatelet that we give, but the problem is how long can we give it for and should we give it for? So as far as the procedure is concerned, we probably should just do the minimum possible procedure, culprit lesion, and leave it with the shortest possible stent, etc. But the choice of stent matters, and whether we put a stent at all. Sometimes, as Dr. Chandrika mentioned in the previous patient as well, angioplasty alone without a stent, if you get a reasonable result, may not be a bad option in this patient as well. If you can get a good result, we don't have to put a stent. But unfortunately, in STEMI patients where they do have a high thrombotic burden, angioplasty alone without a stent may not be always a possible scenario. So in that case, we need to place a stent. So options-wise, we have the old bare metal stents, in which case 4 weeks of dual antiplatelets is recommended. The second generation drug-eluting stents usually require a bit longer duration, 6 months is what they say. However, more recently, we do have the so-called polymer-free drug-eluting stents, where the duration of these dual antiplatelets are more minimal, and we can withhold the dual antiplatelets at 1 month. So that would be my recommendation in this patient. If we are to put a drug-eluting stent, a polymer-free third-generation drug-eluting stent will probably be the best option.
Shyamra, just a quick question. Are these polymer-free stents expensive than the normal drug-eluting ones?
Well, first of all, if we were talking about government service, we know that we do have stents available in the government service. And I believe there are limited stocks of these polymer-free drug-eluting stents as well. For example, I know that it was available at General Hospital. If you're talking private sector, to be honest, no, there is no major price difference. It's actually the same price. So it's widely available and the price is not any different.
So if we do go ahead with PCI, can you give heparin during PCI for these kind of patients? And do you at any point consider platelet transfusions for such patients with thrombocytopenia?
Yes. So to be honest, yeah, that's a good question again. So heparin is something that we do give during the procedure. Periprocedural heparin is something quite important, essentially to prevent stent thrombosis. So the usual heparin dose that we give is 100 units per kilogram body weight. But in a patient who is having thrombocytopenia, obviously we'll be a little bit more cautious about giving heparin. So we reduce the dose. So the recommendation again is to give 30 to 50 units per kilogram rather than the full dose of 100. And more importantly, we need to keep in mind thrombocytopenia and the consequence of giving heparin, which is heparin-induced thrombocytopenia. So I would monitor these patients' platelets very closely, especially after about 5 days, 5 to 10 days after giving heparin, to make sure that the platelet count does not drop any further. So that's very important. And as far as platelet transfusions are concerned, again, there is no guidelines, there is no hard and fast rule. But in general, what they're saying is that there is no real indication to give platelets in these patients, because although they are thrombocytopenic, their functionality, the limited platelets that they have, functionality-wise, they remain the same. So there is no real indication to give platelets unless there are significant indications, such as a patient with low platelets, 20,000 or less, with high fever, leukocytosis, a rapid fall in the platelet count, or if there's any other coagulation abnormality. Apart from those, there is no real reason to give platelets in this patient.
Thank you, Shyamaral. So moving along with this same patient, after successfully managing the acute coronary syndrome, the consultant has ordered atorvastatin 80 milligrams daily among the other drugs. And the house officer is concerned about continuing statins for this patient because of the following investigations. The AST is 120, the ALT is 110, both of which are elevated, and the total bilirubin and the alkaline phosphatase are almost normal. And the ultrasound scan has revealed that the patient has a grade 2 fatty liver. So we have a problem here. The baseline liver function tests are elevated, and the patient has been prescribed atorvastatin. So in this kind of situation, can we give statins if the AST and ALT are increased? Well, the short answer is yes. There are many schools of thoughts as to how far you can initiate statins for this kind of patients. The liver function test elevation, some people think it's 3 times upper limit. Sometimes they say it's 5 times upper limit. But the recent most NICE guideline, which was published in 2020, it says that up to the transaminases up to 3 times upper limit, it's not a problem to initiate statins, and we should not deprive these patients of statins. It is more important to monitor the trend of liver function tests after we start statins. And what the same guideline recommends is that we start the statin at this baseline, which is less than 3 times upper limit in this patient. And then we repeat the liver function test. And if it does not double, we can continue using statins. Why are we so concerned about statins in patients with non-alcoholic fatty liver disease? Well, non-alcoholic fatty liver disease is increasing worldwide, and it also carries with it a very high cardiovascular disease mortality. And statins, as we all know, has pleiotropic effects. They not only have lipid-lowering effects, but they also are anti-inflammatory, they're anti-apoptotic, anti-thrombotic, and they are known to be antioxidants. So it is very important not to deprive patients who actually benefit from statin therapy just because of baseline liver function test abnormalities. Then we come to the question, which has been studied in some researchers: do we actually initiate statins just to improve non-alcoholic fatty liver disease? Well, the data is limited, but with a few selected studies, what they have found is that the transaminases may improve with the treatment of statins, and also the ultrasound findings might improve, but the cardiovascular morbidity and the histology might not improve. And this was further reiterated by a Cochrane systematic review done in 2013. It's a bit old, but that's the latest available, where they studied 2 studies which had very small sample sizes, and there was a lot of risk of bias. So what they said was the transaminases can improve, the imaging findings can improve, but the histology hasn't improved. So there is no clear answer for this question whether statins can improve NAFLD. So we have to wait for more data to come to this conclusion. So statins have always been associated with drug-induced liver injury, and a lot of people associate statin with liver injury. Usually statins increase the liver function test, but if there are larger increases in liver function tests or the transaminases up to about 10 times upper limit, it is usually said not to be due to statins, and we are to investigate for any undiagnosed liver diseases. Because as we know, statins are metabolized by the cytochrome system, so there's always a lot of potential for drug interactions. talking a little bit about statin-induced liver injury, the duration of onset is variable, but is usually very common in the first year of treatment. And the common liver injury that we talk about when we start statins is transaminitis. That is, there is no proven hepatotoxicity. It's just the AST and ALT which go up. And this is usually a class effect, and the patient is asymptomatic. It's dose related and is usually reversible either when the statins are stopped or when the dose is reduced. Whereas actual true liver injury because of statins is very rare in clinical practice. And this liver injury can be in many forms. It can be cholestatic, it can be hepatocellular, and sometimes it can even be autoimmune. So what we are generally concerned about is the transaminitis because that's the one that is common. As we said, that the NICE recommends that if the baseline liver function test doubles within 3 months, that we stop statins. There is a thought process that there is no point in routinely monitoring liver functions in patients who are on statins. Because what they say is the patients who might develop idiosyncratic reactions to statins, we will not be able to identify by routinely repeating the liver function tests. Then again, the guidelines always recommend that when we start the statins, it's always good to do a liver function test because then we know that the baseline liver function test was a certain number. And always it helps us to identify whether the patient has pre-existing abnormalities. And the guidelines also recommend that we repeat the AST and ALT 3 months after treatment and again at 1 year. And again, if the patient's clinical picture changes, say suppose we increase the dose of statin or we change the statin, we can repeat the liver function test. Having said that statins can be used in the non-alcoholic fatty liver disease, there are two indications with regard to liver disease where we don't use statins. That is in acute liver failure and in decompensated cirrhosis. So moving on to the next scenario of the same patient around the follow-up, I would like to invite Prof. Shehan Williams. So this same patient, she was discharged and she comes to the clinic in 3 months and she complains of poor sleep. She had trouble falling asleep almost every night and she woke up at 3 a.m. several mornings a week. She normally wakes up at 6 a.m. She had low energy and lack of concentration to continue her work as a shop assistant, attributed her symptoms to all the side effects of all the strong drugs she was taking. She was on metformin 500 BD, sitagliptin 100 milligrams daily, ramipril 5 milligrams daily, and atorvastatin 40 milligrams noctay, aspirin 75 milligrams noctay, and carvedilol 6.25 BD. And she has been on this regime for the last 3 months. The investigations done in her previous clinic visits are hemoglobin of 10 with a MC of 85, a TSH of 3, which is normal, and a serum creatinine of 2. So I would like to ask Prof. Shehan Williams, can we attribute this patient's symptoms to depression or are these somatic symptoms due to her multimorbidity? And if this is depression, does she need drugs? And if she needs drugs, what is the best treatment for this patient as she has a lot of diseases and she also has a cardiac disease?
Thank you, Dr. Tushara. And also for considering the psychological aspects in the care of this person. Now, it's important to always not work in silos and only think of an acute coronary syndrome in terms of its medical management, but also the long-term outcome for this person. Studies have been done widely on this issue, and these are some figures. I mean, post-MI, up to 1/5 of patients end up with depression. And similarly, following catheterization and even bypass surgery. So it's an important area that we cannot leave to psychiatrists alone. And I think all physicians have to be proactive in identifying depressive disorder and managing it accordingly. So to reinforce, up to 20% of patients meet criteria for major depressive disorder. And almost 2 out of every 5 ACS patients develop depressive disorder. Now, also important is this fact that depression is an independent predictor of morbidity and mortality following cardiac events. So although we focus on the grace points, diabetes, previous MI, and all the other risk factors, in terms of eventual morbidity and mortality, scores on Beck depression inventory correlate with eventual negative outcomes post intervention as well as following ischemic heart disease. So this is an important area that has to be looked at. It relates to diminished health-related quality of life, high costs, and poor medical prognosis. Because as you know, like this classic patient, they try to discontinue medical medication because in our context, they think it is due to or whatever side effects or whatever perceived problems related to depression are interpreted as related to the medicines that are being given. I feel this way is the common outcome. So depression is associated with morbidity and mortality, and depressive symptoms are associated with major adverse coronary events. Therefore, there have been many studies again looking at this, and they even recommend that we look at depression routinely, and there are algorithms that have been developed. And if you look at the symptom profile, I think it's sometimes very difficult to identify because low energy per se, although a symptom of depression, does not really differentiate tiredness following a cardiac event or even heart failure. So we have to look at their interest and motivation, and also persistent low mood, their inability to resume activities, to go back to their job like this lady, and particularly things like persistent negativity, worry, guilt, even concerns about medicine, not following clinics and so on. Particularly medically unexplained symptoms. In Sri Lankan culture, nobody comes and tells you, doctor, I feel depressed. They will come and say, heri denawa, meheri denawa, anger pitch enawa, oluwa thonthu vela, all sorts of symptoms which are not related to any of the cardiac issues, and you feel out of your depth to sort of address this. And also particularly poor attention and concentration, inability to concentrate and also participate in, you know, the exercise regime that is recommended, and all these things are important signs that suggest that this person is now depressed. Particularly this is issue of giving up on life, you know, mata dangi, I don't feel like doing anything sort of thing. So obviously RCTs have been done on cardiac patients to address this issue. And there are many studies that have been done. So what they found, interestingly, is that antidepressants giving them did have effects on depressive symptoms, but unfortunately, the studies were not able to show improved cardiac outcomes following depression treatment. Further analysis did sort of show that in some instances, antidepressants who did not receive antidepressant treatment were prone to adverse outcomes. So depression works in many ways, and we know that now depression is considered as part of a inflammatory process. And in ischemic heart disease too, we know that, you know, cytokines, endothelial dysfunction, and elevation in plasma homocysteine levels play a role. And these do have a role in depression as well. And which is why even this issue of statins are quite important in preventing even depression, and anti-inflammation, antioxidants seem to have a role in the prevention of depressive disorder. So much so that we talk of psychocardiology, and people now think that we have a low threshold for starting antidepressants. But unfortunately, the trials, particularly the ENRICH-D trial, and there are other trials that the SAD Heart and MINDIT trial, which also looked at antidepressants, prescribing them routinely following ischemic heart disease or acute coronary events, don't seem to really be of positive benefit in the populations randomized. So routinely starting antidepressants don't seem to be helping so much in terms of outcome. But there is one study, the COPES 2 study, which was done post ACL, which used a bit of a more broader approach, a step depression care model, where they involved the patient a little bit more and had a specialized team to look after them, and which was followed up for a period, did have show some encouraging results. And this is the sort of trial, if you look at it, I don't know whether you can see it clearly. So post intervention, looking at the cardiac events or whatever, no intervention, there were more events. And in the never depressed group also, there were events, but in where we intervened, sorry, it's the other way, the intervention group had less events. Sorry, intervention group on top had less events, whereas the usual care had very much higher intervention. Here. So therefore, interventions in a step care model looking at depression, a bit of a holistic approach rather than just prescribing antidepressants, did help in overall reducing major adverse cardiac events, mind you. It's not about depression, but it reduced cardiac events because you address the issue of depressive disorder. Now, if you were to use antidepressant, then I think this person, it's really worth a trial, going from what she has been saying. And the most preferred is sertraline and fluoxetine. Generally, cardiac say you can use them post, MI immediately following a acute event. The others sometimes that are used are paroxetine, fluoxetine, but I think first line sertraline, fluoxetine, quite safe, well tried out. Caution with citalopram and escitalopram, because in high doses they cause QT prolongation. And one thing when you add in sertraline or fluoxetine SSRI that you have to keep in mind is that they are going to decrease platelet aggregation. So when you're using aspirin and clopidogrel concomitantly, and now if you are using warfarin, you have to take this into account because it will have some impact. And so it may be a beneficial effect eventually. And there is some insignificant sinus node slowing, which can really be ignored. Now, other antidepressants which are useful are drugs like mirtazapine, usually has some sedative effects. But to be avoided are venlafaxine, duloxetine, and the tricyclics. Now, a lot of people do seem to use them because, these are marketed widely. But see, tricyclics particularly have a lot of issues with the heart. They do prolong the QTC interval, and they may precipitate even ventricular fibrillation. And finally, just to capture, sometimes it's even worthwhile in severe depression cases considering ECT if they are not improving, not particularly for this patient. This patient, I think, would benefit more from a little bit of psychological support, supporting her and encouraging her to get back to work. So that's where maybe a referral to the psychiatric team will be useful, because they may be able to bring in some resources to support her to get her back into work. But even in another situation where a person is very down, we can consider ECT even if the ejection fraction is quite low. And even between a range of 15 to 40%, people improved significantly. Thank you.
Thank you, Prof. Shehan. So that concludes the case scenario on this patient. I hope we gain some insight as to how to handle therapeutic dilemmas. Thank you.